number 531 in your hymnal, 531. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Would you stand with me, please, as we sing 531 together on that first? All hail the power of Jesus' name. Prostrate fall. Bring forth the
singing this morning. Welcome to the morning service. Good to see everybody here today. Let's open with a word of prayer together, shall we? Father, we thank you for this morning. Thank you for another Lord's Day that you've blessed us with. And Lord, we are always excited when we realize it's Sunday morning. We get to come to church. We get to be with the people of God, get to sing the songs of God like we just sang. And Lord, I'm excited to be in church today and looking forward to what you want to do in my life and in the lives and hearts of people that are gathered here this morning. And so, Father, we bow here at the beginning of the service and ask you to minister to our hearts. Help us to put aside from our mind and our thoughts things that would want to grab our attention, that would take our mind away from focusing on what you would want to say to us this morning. And so, Lord, use the music, use our fellowship together. Lord, use the Word of God in each one of our lives this morning to accomplish your will and your purpose that you desire for each one of us. May your will be done. May you be pleased with the service today. It's in Christ's name that we ask it. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Among us, all that he does, all of his mercy, all of his love, the pen of the writer could write every day, even this world could never contain, just how I've been blessed. Warmth in the winter, flowers in spring, laughter in summer, the changing of leaves, food on my table, a good place to sleep, clothes on my back and shoes on my feet. Oh, how I've been blessed. I have been blessed. God's so good to me. Precious are his thoughts of you and me. No way I could count them, there's not enough time. So I'll just thank him for being so kind. God has been good, so good. I have been blessed. Arms that can raise, a voice that can talk, hands that can touch, and legs that can walk, ears that can listen, eyes that can see. Oh, I've got to praise him as long as I breathe. I have been blessed. Mother and father, nurtured and raised, brother and sister, memories made. our pastor to lead us, taught you to pray. Stripes that can heal and the blood that can save. Oh, I have been blessed. I have been blessed. God's so good to me. Precious are his thoughts of you and me. The way I could count them is not enough time. So I'll just thank him for being so kind. God has been good, so good. I have been blessed. We live in a country, the greatest on earth. Our flag stands for freedom and what it is worth. She stands in the harbor, Miss Liberty calls. All have gave some, but some gave it all. For me to be blessed. There's my source to lean on when I am down. The rock where he leads me when I'm overwhelmed. The place where he hides me under his wings. He's not just a song, he's the reason I sing. I have been blessed. I have been blessed. He's so good to me. Precious are his thoughts of you and me. The way I could count them, there's not enough time. So I'll just thank him for being so kind. God has been good, so good. I have been blessed. God has been good, so good. I have been blessed.
Amen. Let's go over 283 together, 283. There's joy unspeakable and full of glory. 283, I have found his grace is all complete. I have found his grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. While I sit and learn at Jesus' feet, I am free as free indeed. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, the half has never yet been told. On that third, I have found hope so bright and clear, living in the realm of grace. Oh, the Savior's presence is so near, I can see his smiling face. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, that has never yet been told. I have found the joy no tongue can tell, how its waves of glory roll. It is like a great o'erflowing well, springing up within my soul. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, the half has never yet been told.
All right. Now we have some announcements. Listen carefully, if you would. We have our regular schedule again today. 5:30 is our Christian growth class. It meets in the conference room. 5:30 tonight, and start the new cycle now. And tonight's lesson, of course, we start with salvation and assurance of salvation. And so that'll be tonight at 5:30 in the conference room. Then 6:30 tonight, our evening service right back here. And we have Evangelist Tim Booth who will be with us this evening. He's preaching down in Lancaster this morning. And then he'll be with us tonight. You're happy about that, I can tell. All right. And he's applauding the pastor won't be preaching tonight. I'll get you, Roy, all right? And I'll get you, buddy. And but we look forward to Brother Booth. He hasn't been here for a while, and excited. He did a great job Friday night at RU, and really enjoyed it. You're going to enjoy him this evening. So we'll be back tonight at 6:30 for that. All right. A reminder, those of you enrolled in the Grove City School of the Bible that meets normally on Tuesday evening, because our service is Tuesday night this week, your class is tomorrow night. Remember that. Tomorrow night, 7 o'clock for the Grove City School of the Bible. And then our midweek service this week is Tuesday instead of Wednesday because of Thanksgiving. And we give you the opportunity to travel on Wednesday and not miss church. So we'll have our worker appreciation service Tuesday night, 7 o'clock, all right? That's a great service. Hope you don't just plan on being here for that. It's a great night together, okay? And then, let's see. There's a sign-up sheet for the men's breakfast coming up December 3rd. That's down there on the table. Ladies, your Christmas meeting is coming up on December the 5th, and that is Treasures of the Snow. And that's going to be at 6 o'clock on Monday, December the 5th, over in the Fellowship Hall. The announcement about that's in the bulletin. I think there's a sign-up sheet for that downstairs as well. And so you take advantage of that. And then our Christmas banquet's coming up out at Dear Dutchman again. And you can see Carol Coleman for those to get that reserved for you. She'll be down in the lobby after the service today, 6:30. For that on Monday, December the 12th. And I mean, you eat like only they can serve it. And you get some of their pie and everything. It's a great, great night. Great entertainment, good fun, good fellowship, great food, and well worth a night out. So you'll enjoy that together. You see Carol to reserve your spot for that on December the 12th, okay? All right. That's, I think, all I've got right now. All right, let's take a moment, and we'll welcome any of our guests that are with us today. And let's, I think, you know, Paul and Lonnie, right? You guys are back from last week. Good to see you guys here this morning. Thank you for being here. Adam and Charisma, they're back from last week. Good to see you here this morning. That's great. We have a couple right behind them visiting from Pensacola. Now, go ahead and introduce yourselves again, would you please? Paul and Brooke Mass. They're passing through and just stopped in for church this morning, and sure glad you did. Thank you. Great to have you this morning. All right. Is there anyone else this morning visiting here that for the first time? Everybody good? All right. If you'll take just a moment and fill out the welcome card, we appreciate you doing that. And a little bit, we have the offering. Just drop that card in the plate if you would, and keep the pen as our gift to you for coming. Glad you're here today. Let's give these guests a warm welcome, shall we?
Glory and grace.
335. If you would, turn to 335, showers of blessing. There shall be showers of blessing. This is a promise of love. You may remain seated on that first together. There shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of love. There shall be seasoned refreshing sent from the Savior above. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, precious reviving I can. Over the hills and the valleys, sound of abundance of rain. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. As we sing this last stanza together, children, you can be dismissed to junior church. Children, you're dismissed to junior church. On that last all together, there shall be showers of blessing. Oh, that today they might fall. Now as to God we're confessing. Showers of blessing. Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. Amen. Great singing this morning. Let's go over to 223, if you would. 223, draw me near, 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 blessed Lord. Let's all stand together. And when you find 223, I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. Let's sing that verse together. I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me near, near, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me near, near, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you. blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me near, near, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. There are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross the narrow sea. Let's sing that last stanza together. When we get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out. On that last, there are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross a narrow sea. There are heights of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me near, near, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side.
Everybody said? You can be seated. Great singing this morning. Ushers will come and they'll receive our offering this morning. And we'll ask God's blessing on our giving today. Have Brother Wallace lead us in prayer, if you would please, Brother Bob.
Let us pray. Father, thank you again, Lord, for being such a great God. And Father, we're here to learn from you. And as we open up your word and as your servant gives us your word that you've given him, Lord, help us to apply what is needed to each and every one of our lives. And Lord, we're all different. And Lord, we all grow in a different way. But Lord, we got a great God that can give each and every one of us exactly what we need. So Lord, we would ask that you do that. Father, bless the offering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Take your Bibles this morning for our scripture reading, if you would please, to Psalm 100. Psalm 100. While you're turning there, you want to remember James Bragg in your prayers, if you would. This is Ray Cart. Ray, put your hand up there. His brother-in-law, okay? Most of you know who he is, and his brother-in-law has cancer, and he's very, very critical. So be praying for him, if you would. James Bragg. Psalm 100 is our scripture reading for today, and it's just five verses, and so we're going to read it in unison this morning. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read God's word. All of us standing, please, and we'll begin verse 1, and we'll read it in unison together through verse number 5. Ready? Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. And let's pray. Father, we do ask you to add your blessing to the reading of your word here this morning. I want to thank you, Lord, for the Bible. Thank you so much for providing the scriptures for us, that we have the word of God. And Lord, I'm praying that you will open our hearts and our understanding this morning, that we'll receive from the word what you would have us to receive. Lord, we do lift up James Bragg this morning and dealing with this cancer. Pray for great grace to be upon him and the family members as well during this time. And Father, we pray that you will help us now to be prepared to receive the truth from your word this morning. Prepare our hearts that we'll be in tune with your heart. Use the special to that end. In Jesus' name, amen.
Riches, dear Lord, take everything. If I must be blind to see the light, let my eyes sightless be. If I must suffer in anguish to show men thy great consolation, if it takes all of this, let thy grace be sufficient for me. If friends must despise me for wearing thy name, let me faithful be. If I must lay aside my dreams to follow thee, let me not fall astray. If my cross seems too heavy, please let me see more of thy glory. If it takes all of this, let thy grace be sufficient for me. Let thy grace be sufficient for me. Let thy grace be sufficient for me. And whatever may come, let thy will be done. Let thy grace be sufficient for me. I must live and die a lonely life just to know thee more fully. If I must lose my life and all I have just to find rest in thee, let me realize my treasure lies in showing the world more of Jesus. It may take all of this, but thy grace is sufficient for me. Yes, thy grace is sufficient for me. Wondrous grace, all
Now, our Father, we bow in prayer as we come to the preaching of your word. Again, Father, I thank you for the Bible. I thank you, Lord, that we have copies of your word in our hands this morning. Lord, I pray that each of us would give our careful attention to your word this morning, not as the words of man or the words of men, but as it is in truth, the words of God. Lord, it would effectually work in each of us that believe this morning, that you would help us to obey the instruction of this song of being thankful unto you. And so, Lord, help us to focus and concentrate and give us ears to hear what the Spirit would say to the church this morning. And I'll thank you for it, I pray in Christ's name. Amen. Bob Jones Sr. said that when gratitude dies on the altar of a man's heart, that man is well nigh hopeless. By nature, you understand, we're not thankful. In fact, if you have any small ones around your home or grandchildren or whatever it may be, you have to teach them to be thankful. When they come up and want a piece of candy or they want something and you give that to them, you say, "Now what do you say?" And they have to say, "Thank you." That doesn't come naturally. You have to be taught that, okay? You have to be taught to be thankful because by nature, we're unthankful. By nature, we're sinners. By nature, we're depraved. Sometimes they say, "Well, how come my child does that?" Because they're your child, okay? Because they're depraved like you are, and they're a sinner. And so we're just naturally self-centered and proud. And somebody says, "Oh, pray for me. I got a problem with pride." Well, then you're human. That's just called being a sinner. And we all have that difficulty. And so if we just do what comes naturally, we will not be thankful. We will be unthankful. So I remember reading a soldier in the army underneath Patton's command was sent to a rest camp after a period of active duty. And he returned to his outfit after the rest. He wrote a letter to General Patton, thanking him for the rest, thanking him for the time off. And Patton wrote the man a letter back. And he said, "For 35 years, I've tried to give comfort and conveniences to my men, but this was the first letter of thanks I've ever received in return." In 35 years, we are not naturally thankful. And so here in Psalm 100, we're instructed in verse number 4 to enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Notice, be thankful unto him and bless his name. Twice we're told to be thankful unto him. We're told to enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Over in the New Testament, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, there's a lot of simple instructions given at the end of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And Paul pens these words in verse 18, "In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you." Now, he didn't say for everything, but he did say in everything. Because no matter whether everything happens today as you planned it or not, I'll guarantee you it happens the way God planned it. Okay? You may be surprised at some things that happened today, but God will not be surprised. He knows exactly what's in store. And so we can in everything give thanks. Then if you would, look at Romans chapter 1 with me this morning. Romans chapter 1 gives a very detailed description of the slide away from God that mankind has put themselves on and mankind pursues. And we can certainly see our country in this process as well, as it goes all the way down to where they will not acknowledge God, and of course they'll not inherit the kingdom of God. But in Romans 1, I want you to notice the Bible says, because that, in verse 21, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful. Then they became vain in their imaginations. Their foolish heart was darkened. They professed to be wise, but they're fools. They changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man, to birds, to four-footed beasts, creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. They changed the truth of God into a lie. They worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. And then, of course, God gives them over to vile affections, and down the slippery slope they go. But where did it start? They knew God, and they wouldn't glorify Him as God. Neither were they thankful. That's amazing that that would rank that high up in the list, is it not? That they weren't thankful. And so I want to help us to be thankful this morning. I want to help us. And listen, if we're not thankful, we'll never be thankful. And so we have to think about it this morning. And let me give you just very simple thoughts today, but I hope some thoughts that will help us to not just, by the way, thankfulness for a Christian is not just a time of year, and it isn't just a holiday once a year. We're to be giving thanks all year long. We're to be thankful people to God all the time. In everything, give thanks. This is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. But the first thing I want to bring to your attention today is we have to realize who to thank. Realize who to thank. Verse 21 of Romans 1, when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful. It is very difficult to express your gratitude to God when you don't believe it's God who gave you what you have. But the Bible says in James 1 and verse 17 that every good and every perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Everything I have, everything you have, has come from the hand of God. And when we're thankful, I know who to thank. I know who to go to. It's God who needs our thankfulness, who desires our thankfulness. I remember our first little house that we had when we got married down in South Carolina, 211 Anderson Street. It was a old house that was really divided up into three sections. The bottom section, the lady who owned the house lived in half of that. We lived in the other half. We had a living room, a bedroom, we had a little kitchen, and we had a bathroom. There was no heat in the kitchen or the bathroom. And really, there were two gas heaters, and one in the living room, one in the bedroom, that you had to get up in the morning and hold the thing down and get a match and light it, you know, and then turn it up and then jump back into bed and wait for it to warm up till you got out of bed. And that didn't always make it into the bathroom, I'll guarantee it. But it was those were, and what you do for the kitchen, turn the burners on and heated the stove up and warm that up. And that's how we lived. No, listen, it was home. Hardwood floors, no carpeting, but it was home, and it was our first home, and great memories of that place. And then the house we lived up in Indiana at 6232 Monroe really was a converted garage that we lived in. And it wasn't, I was thinking as I was putting this together this week that it was, that place, I'm pretty sure it was smaller than this platform up here, and that we lived in, and just, right on the, it wasn't where the houses were. It sat, because it was a garage, and they converted it to like a little house, and it sat back on the alley where the trash cans were. The people come through the alley to empty the trash cans. That's where that sat, and we lived there. The one little bedroom and the living room, and then a kitchen and a bathroom, and but we did have carpeting in the living room. Amen. We were moving up, and but I remember the cold winter mornings and ice on the inside of the window. And just, I remember when it would rain real hard, it would start coming in the kitchen door. I remember Brother Danny going out there and with a shovel, you know, and I'm trying to dig trenches to get the water to run away from coming inside inside the place. And but that was home. And we enjoyed that. We had what we slept on was one of those old, it was an old couch that my grandparents owned. And it was, so I guess, and then when you took the back of the couch and pulled it forward, and then it would lay down, and you could lay on like that. But the one side back here had a spring that stuck up. So we always had the race to see who get in bed first and not get the side with the spring on it, you know. But what a time that was. Great days. And I think about those places when we enjoy the nice home we have now. And three bedrooms and heating and air conditioning and carpeted floors. And I mean, you a nice fenced yard and a fireplace. And you know, when you begin to count your blessings, you know what? I know who to thank. That's God. God has allowed that to happen. God has been good to us. And I don't want to take the blessings of God for granted. I don't want to just go through life and have these things and see where God has brought us and not thank Him for what He has done. God's good to us. Brother Jarvis says, God's good God. He does good things. And He does good things for us. And so the doxology says, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Not many churches, I suppose, ever sing that anymore. But there's good truth in that. And we miss that. So I realize who to thank. The second thought I want to give you today is we have to remember to count our blessings. Psalm 103, the 103rd Psalm. We read the 100th Psalm. You're familiar with Psalm 103 as well, I'm sure. David says in Psalm 103, verse 1, he says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. And then he begins to list all the benefits that the Lord is bringing to his mind. And that's what you have to do. There's times, in order not to forget, you have to count your blessings. There's every now and then you need to just get alone somewhere, get out a 3x5 card or get out a piece of paper and begin to list your blessings. If you don't focus on what you have and how God has blessed you, you will begin to focus on what you don't have. And you will get discouraged and you will get negative. That's what the devil would have you focus on. Someone wrote this, count your blessings instead of crosses. Count your gains instead of losses. Count your joys instead of woes. Count your friends and not your foes. Count your smiles instead of tears. Count your courage and not your fears. Count the full years, not the lean. Count the kind deeds, not the mean. Count your health instead of your wealth. And count on God instead of yourself. Good way to live. Thank God. Did you thank God you're healthy enough to be in church today? Did you thank God you're healthy enough to come, that you can see, that you can hear, that you can walk, that you can breathe, that you're able to be in church this morning? Do you know if you own a Bible, you're abundantly blessed, as nearly half the world doesn't have one? If you've never experienced a war zone, the loneliness of imprisonment, the agony of torture, the pangs of starvation, then you're ahead of over 500 million people in the world. If you have food in your refrigerator, if you have clothes on your back, a roof over your head, and a place to sleep, you're better off than 75% of the people in the world. If you have a bank account, if you have some money in your wallet this morning or in your purse, if you have spare change in a jar or some container at home, did you know you're among the top 8% of the people in the world? Have you counted your blessings? Have you counted your blessings? Somebody ought to thank God. Somebody ought to be praising God. Someone ought to be, listen, when you think about those things, you ought to say, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. We are abundant. He has been exceeding abundantly above all we ask or think, good to us. Our hearts ought to be overflowing. We have so much. In fact, we have more than what we need. You know, One reason that the communists did not defeat us is we could outproduce them. If you remember seeing the pictures, the store shelves, and just a few loaves of bread sitting there are mostly empty. When they could look at our shelves, and it was full of things. In fact, it was amazing, and I don't remember the exact number now, but I remember reading a statistic about how many items were in a grocery store in like 1976. And it was something like maybe 4,000 things or something like that, and now I think it's like 20-some thousand items in a store. It's unbelievable. You think about it. You used to go to the grocery store because you were getting groceries. Now you get everything there. Everything's there. It's amazing. And so, in order to keep that system, the shelves have to continually be packed with different consumer goods. And there's one thing we have to do to keep our system thriving. You know what it is? Buy stuff. We have to buy stuff. What's everybody concerned right now? How are the sales going to be for Christmas? What's the fourth quarter going to be? How much profit are they going to make? Are people spending money? Because that's important to our system. We have to buy the stuff our system produces. The way of life of America, I'm talking about Americana. Listen, about the capitalism is that we continue to buy stuff that we don't necessarily need. Everybody here has stuff at your house, and you don't know why it's there, but it's there. And you have some stuff you've looked at sometimes and said, man, we ought to get rid of that, but you don't. It's still there. The truth is we have the money to buy all the stuff that our factories produce, and yet we already have things we need. I didn't say we have everything we want, but we do have everything we need. Think about some of you will relate to this, I think. When you think about Christmas and what you want to get for certain people, it's not about sometimes having the money or figuring out where to get the money to buy for your family and your friends. What you're trying to figure out is, what do I buy for them? They have everything. Should we get them? No, they got one of those. Well, can I get them that? No, we got that 3 years ago. And you start thinking, say, what do you get somebody who I think has everything already? You know, what do you do in those situations? What you should buy for people who have everything is nothing. Wow. But nobody has the guts to pull it off. That's the problem. No, you know what you do? You go up and down the aisle. Or you click and point and click and point and go to different websites and you're trying to find just the right thing. That maybe somebody's invented something that nobody else has. You can get one. You know, everybody likes to feel appreciated. There was a job satisfaction survey several years ago that showed employees were willing to accept less pay if they would receive more recognition and felt appreciated. That's amazing. The power of appreciation can't be underestimated. Many, you know what? Many marriages run into problems. You know why? Because one spouse or the other, one of them feels unappreciated. That they're taken for granted. The things they do. And then you're headed for trouble. Friendships fall by the wayside because friends lose touch with one another. And they lose touch because we don't take the time to keep in touch with each other and to show appreciation. Ever think about how long does it take to really say thank you? How long does it take to get out a card and to write a little note and say thanks for what you did, I appreciate you? I wonder how many friendships have been hurt. I wonder how many relationships have been damaged just because we wouldn't take 5 minutes to show thankfulness and show appreciation. Thank you notes have become a lost art in our society. When just a few minutes can make a huge difference in somebody's life. One Christmas, this fellow wrote this week, I was reading this story this week, he said, one Christmas there were two people I wanted to buy really special gifts for. He said, they lived far away from me and we didn't have a lot of contact, but I cared very deeply for them and I decided that I wanted to give them something really special to show the depth of my love and appreciation. He said, I went out in the quest for the perfect gifts, and I decided gift bags would be the best so I could choose multiple gifts and be sure to please them. And I went to all the local stores where I lived as well as online to make my budget stretch as far as possible. I was so excited. I filled the gift bags with lovely luxuries I knew they were sure to enjoy, and I sent them on their way. He said, Christmas came and Christmas went, and every time the phone rang, he said, I was sure it was going to be one of them calling to say, thanks for the wonderful gifts. He said, but it wasn't. The call never came. There was never a note of thanks, a letter, or even an email. He said, to this day, I don't know if they ever enjoyed their gifts or if they ever even received them. You know, being thankful becomes a lifestyle. It becomes how you live. It's are you going to look at your cup as half full or will you look at it as half empty? Being thankful every day for the people in your life, for the blessings you have in your life. There's many people around that you can appreciate and let them know you appreciate them. Let them know that you're thankful that they're in your life. One of the sad things in our culture is we wait till they're dead. And then we want to stand up at their funeral and say what a blessing they were to us. Now, if they're saved, they're going to hear you from heaven and they'll get to listen in, and that's fine. But, you know, it's so much better. Tell them why they're here. What a blessing they are. How often do we express our appreciation? William Arthur Ward said this, feeling gratitude and not expressing it is like wrapping a present and never giving it. What good would it do to think of somebody and think of a gift you could give to them, get it, wrap it up, put a nice bow on it, and then leave it sit at your house and never give it to them? Wouldn't do any good at all. So it is when we think, listen, here's a good thing to do. If you think something nice about somebody, tell them. Say it. Okay? And if you don't, listen, and if you don't think something nice, then be quiet. And don't go tell them, boy, I had a bad thought about you, but I ask God to forgive me. Don't do that. Because then you know what they think about? I wonder what they were thinking. Okay? Don't do that. It's funny. All the things that have been invented in the last 30, 40 years that was intended to give us so much more time. You don't have to do the dishes. You just rinse them off, put them in that dishwasher, and it washes the dishes for you. Look at all the time you'll save. You don't have to even cook this anymore. Hey, you don't have to wait for the water to boil. You just stick it in this little box here, press a few buttons, and in 30 seconds you got hot tea, hot coffee, whatever you want. Look at all the time you'll save. Everything is instant. I don't even have to open the refrigerator, get out that tray, crack it, dump some ice cubes out, fill it back up with water, stick it back. I just have to stick my cup in the door and it goes, blah, 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 fills my cup up. Look at all the time I save getting ice. But wait, there's more. Hey, you don't even have to get up and turn the channel anymore. Some of you kids, you don't even know what that is. Huh? How many of you, when you were younger, your parents didn't need a remote because you were the remote? Yeah. Get up and turn the channel. You had to get up and go do it. Now, you feel really deprived if you didn't have one of them. In fact, just lose it for a little bit and see what goes on at your house. Huh? Ladies, and you have men like that? Where's the remote? Huh? Yeah. Oh, boy. All this time we're supposed to have, and then the phones and the smartphones and all that, and we're supposed to, and you know what? Everybody says, I'm so busy. Oh, I meant to do that. I just didn't have time. Amazing, isn't it? Maybe some other things need to come off our schedules. You see, if we're too busy to be appreciative, if we're too busy to be thankful, then maybe we're far busier than God ever intended for us to be. There's a difference between, you know, Jesus, when he prayed there in John 17, we went through that in Sunday school. But you know, he said, I've finished the work thou gavest me to do. Jesus said, I've done what you gave me to do. And can I tell you this morning, every one of us can do what God has given us to do. Our problem is, we're probably doing some things that God hasn't told us to do, but we want to do. There is a difference, and by the way, they may not be bad things, but there is a difference between goodwill and God's will. And so often, when it comes down to it then, and we're trying to decide, what do I cut out? Be careful you don't cut out what God's will is for your goodwill. There's some things that are good, but it may not be what God wants you to do. He's going to have someone else do that. But you need to make sure it's what God wants you to do so you don't get overwhelmed. You know, the pilgrims made 7 times more graves than they did huts to live in. Yet they set aside a day for thanksgiving to God. The first American Thanksgiving is largely attributed to 1621, when a group of pilgrims shared their feast with the Indians. But the truth is, the first recorded Thanksgiving took place in Virginia more than 11 years earlier than that, in 1610 at Jamestown. Their settlement had been reduced from 409 to 60. The survivors had gathered together and prayed for help without knowing when or how it might come. Help arrived in the form of a ship filled with food and supplies from England, and a prayer meeting was held to give thanks to God for His provision. That's thankful. World War II, there were 2 couples waiting to talk to the pastor after church. And one couple said to the pastor, our son was killed in the war and we would like to give $200 for a memorial gift in his name. The couple standing behind them was next in line and they heard that conversation. And they thought about their son who also served in the war but came home strong and healthy. They too went to the pastor and they handed him a check for $500. And the pastor said, why? Your son wasn't killed in the war. And they said, that's exactly right. If they can give $200 for a son they lost in the war, we can give $500 for a son that wasn't lost in the war. And be thankful. A thinking mind will produce a grateful heart. A thinking mind will produce a grateful heart. I love this illustration. The man was wanting to sell his home, so he called the realtor. He says, I want to sell my house as soon as possible. Realtor said, okay, tell me some things about your house for me to put in the advertisement. And he went through how many bedrooms it had and the bathrooms and the carpeting and the nice deck and the fireplace and the fruit trees in the backyard, central heat, air conditioning. And the realtor said, okay, all right, now let me read it back to you and see how it sounds. And the realtor starts reading back to the man what he described to him. And as he's reading, the man says, "Stop. Stop." He said, "That house isn't for sale." He said, "I've been looking for a house like that all my life. I didn't realize I had it till right now." And he decided to stay where he was. Are you thankful for what you have? Are you obeying God's command to be ye thankful? Have you counted your blessings? Have you ever just wrote down the things you ought to be thankful for? When you enter the gates of heaven, I'll guarantee you this. Well, I can't imagine what I'll see. I know what the Bible says. I know the streets of gold. I know the fruit trees. I know the river of life. I understand all that. I know what I read. I'm not sure I can, whatever a picture I could have in my mind would do it justice. But I know when I see it, boy, will I be thankful for salvation. Boy, will I be thankful that Jesus died for me. I will be so thankful that I was saved. So thankful that somebody told me about Jesus Christ and I could receive Him as my Savior. So thankful that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. So thankful that God commended His love toward us and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So thankful that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So thankful that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Man, I'll be thankful for salvation. So thankful that I have eternal life. My friend, if you don't have eternal life today, oh, you're missing out. And it isn't just for then, though it'll be great then. I'll testify to you, it's great now. It's great living for God now. If there wasn't a heaven to go to, and there is, but if there wasn't heaven to go to, I would still want to live for Jesus Christ on this earth. It's a great life. It's a wonderful life. And that ain't Jimmy Stewart. That's Jesus Christ. Amen. It really is a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's be thankful. Let's enter into the gates with thanksgiving, into His courts with praise. Let's be thankful unto Him and praise His name. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, take the truth now this morning. Thank You, Lord, for Your goodness to us. Lord, I pray that each of us would take time today, tomorrow, this week, and realize who we need to thank. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Without You, we're nothing. We have nothing. Everything we have, we've received from You. And we would take time to count the blessings. So we would not forget all Your benefits to us. You've been good to all of us in this room. Lord, I pray that we would cultivate gratitude. Cultivate thankfulness in our lives, not just one time a year, but every day of the year. We would learn that in everything to give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. And Lord, if any in the room today has never received Your gift of eternal life, I pray they'd receive and accept Jesus as their Savior today. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I'll finish praying in just a moment. But right now, just between you and God, I wonder how many here this morning would say, "Pastor, I'll be able to thank God for eternal life because there's a time in my life when I asked Christ to be my Savior. There's a time in my life I knew I was a sinner and I needed to be saved and Jesus was the Savior I needed. And I trusted Him as my Savior and I am trusting Him as my Savior to take me to heaven one day. Pastor, here's my hand as a testimony. Would you slip it up for a moment that I may see it? I know that I'm saved." All right, you may put it down. You here today would say, "Pastor, I don't know for sure. I don't know for sure that I'd get to heaven when I die. I don't have that assurance in my heart, but I'd like to have that assurance. Would you let me pray for you this morning? I'd like to do that." Would you slip your hand up and say, "Pray for me this morning, Pastor"? God bless you. God bless you. Anyone else today say, "Pastor, pray for me"? I wonder how many believers here today would say, "Pastor, I realize who to thank, and I realize I need to count my blessings. I don't want to be unthankful. I'm going to ask God to help me count my blessings this week, and I'm going to give praise to Him for His goodness to me. Pastor, the Lord spoke to my heart this morning. Here's my hand. Pray for me this morning. Would you slip it up, Christian? Amen. Amen. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray. We'll have our invitation. If you're not sure, if you died, you go to heaven. You're not sure you have eternal life. When I'm done praying, we'll stand to our feet. The pianist will play. Brother Bob's going to sing. And when we begin the invitation, as soon as that piano hits the first note, you slip from your seat and come. Other people will be coming to pray. You come. We'll have someone take a Bible. And they'll show you from the Bible how you can know you have eternal life and how you can know you're on your way to heaven. Christian, you just want to come and bow the knee to the Lord and begin to thank Him. Thank Him for your family. Thank Him for your friends. Thank Him for His provision. Thank Him for His protection. Thank Him for His grace, for His mercy, for His love, for His calling on your life, for what He's done for you, for what He has done, what He is doing, what He will do. Just count your blessings this morning. Heavenly Father, thank You for speaking to our hearts today. Cultivate in us the attitude of gratitude to You. Oh Lord, let us express our thankfulness to You this morning. Our praise to You. You're worthy of our praise. You're worthy of our gratitude. Hear our prayer we make this morning to You now. Have Your way in this invitation. May every individual do what You're bidding them to do in their heart. And I'll thank You for it. With their heads bowed, stand to your feet if you would. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. She plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. You respond to Him this morning now, will you?
Thank You, Lord.
That's right.
For saving my soul. Thank You, Lord, for making me whole. Thank You, Lord, for giving to me Thy great salvation so rich and free. Some thank the Lord for friends and home, for mercy sure and sweet. But I would praise Him for His grace. In prayer I would repeat, saving my soul. Thank You, Lord, for making me whole. Thank You, Lord, for giving to me Thy great salvation so rich and free. Some thank Him for the flowers that grow, some for the stars that shine. My heart is filled with joy and praise because I know He's mine. Thank You, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank You, Lord, for making me whole. Thank You, Lord, for giving to me Thy great salvation so rich and free.
Do the chorus again.
Thank You, Lord.
Sing it with Him.
For saving my soul. Thank You, Lord, for making me whole. Thank You, Lord, for giving to me Thy great salvation so rich and free.
Go ahead and be seated for a minute if you would. We'd have one man come forward this morning, and we're going to deal with him and be thorough with him. But I wanted to let you know, we have some more bags, what we call bags of hope, okay? And by the way, there's 40 back there, okay? So take one with you. That will make 1,000 now that have been passed out from the church. Brother Wright gets these ready, he and his wife, and says they're celebrating 1,000 bags of hope at Bible Baptist Church. There's water, toothpaste, soups, a breakfast bar, shampoo, conditioner, mouthwash, soap, and a Reformers Unanimous gospel track in here. And see those folks somewhere, a homeless person or somebody standing wanting help? There's your opportunity to give them one and be a blessing to them. And because there, but for the grace of God, go you. Amen. And you never know what it'll do to someone to let them know you care. And that's really an amazing. Gonna pack a lot of stuff in there, brother. And that's great. So these are back there. Where are they back there? In a bag. You're gonna be back there, Brother Danny. Why don't you go back there and give them out, and ask the Lord to lead you and guide you and who to give that to, and he'll have somebody cross your path that you'll be able to be a blessing to them. All right. Don't forget the different sign-up sheets down there. Take a look and see what you need to get plugged into. And don't forget those of you in the Grove City School of the Bible tomorrow night, 7 o'clock, for your classes. And make sure you remember that. All right, tonight, 6:30, Brother Booth. Don't miss him. You'll enjoy it. It'll be a great service together this evening. All right, let's stand together for a word of prayer, shall we? Father, thank you for today. Thank you for a wonderful morning with the people of God. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for allowing us to listen in and go through the prayer of Jesus in John 17. Thank you, Lord, for cultivating in our heart thankfulness. And help us to be thankful to you for your goodness to us. We love you. We're so thankful you're our God. Thank you for our church. Thank you for each individual that's present in the service today. Be with our friends from Pensacola here as they continue to travel. Give them safety over the highway, Lord, and get them safely to their destination. Father, we love you. Give us a good afternoon and prepare us and bring us back for the service this evening. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Brother Bob?
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You're dismissed. We'll see you tonight.